Hello friends. In this video tutorial, I want to return to the topic of managing smart lighting. I have previously demonstrated various practical examples in my earlier videos. You can find links to some of them in the description below the video. Today, we will talk about dimming, adjusting brightness using logical switches and buttons. As always, a text file with the example shown in the video will be available in the description below the video. In the meantime, as usual, I kindly ask you to like this video. It will help others interested in the topic of smart homes find it. Don't forget to subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. As a logical switch, I will be using a wireless Zigbee button from Xiaomi, one of the most popular models. However, everything shown here is applicable to any similar devices. Manufacturer and ecosystem do not matter. The light fixture in this case is a bulb from the Tuya ecosystem, operating via Zigbee. For it, a wireless Zigbee dimmer that works in direct binding mode will be convenient. However, the method shown in this lesson applies to any devices, Zigbee, Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, Thread, and so on. We will start with a scenario that uses two events. In this case, holding the button initiates dimming, and releasing the button stops it, as the release event is automatically generated when the button is released after being held. However, you can use other events as well, multiple presses, rotating the dimmer knob, and so on. We will also need two logical switches, input booleans. One is needed to start and stop dimming, and the other determines the dimming direction, since brightness can either increase or decrease. You can create these switches in the helper's menu of the system interface. To do this, click the Create button, then select the toggle option in the menu and specify its name and icon. However, as usual, I create everything in a single text file, a package. This is much more convenient, visually clear, and makes it much easier to transfer to another system or to create similar controls for different light fixtures. Here are the same switches created in a package. Each light fixture should have its own switches, which means they must have different names. In the interface, these switches are not used. They are technical entities, and I have displayed them only to demonstrate how they work. They differ from each other, apart from their names, in their initial status, which they receive when the system starts up. The dimming switch is off, and the dimming direction switch is on, meaning that brightness will increase on the first launch. If you remove this line, the switch will remember its previous state. Now let's move on to automations, which contain all the logic. The first automation is quite small. It handles turning the light on and off. This block is the header of the automation. It contains the name, a unique identifier for each automation. I usually use identical names and identifiers that are never repeated, a description where any text can be used, and the initial status of the automation in Home Assistant, enabled. The first mandatory section is triggers. These are one or more events that cause the automation to activate. I use the state platform and monitor the action sensor of the Xiaomi button, single press. There are no conditions for this automation. This section is optional and is omitted in this case. The last section, actions, is mandatory, just like triggers. This is a service for toggling the light fixture's state. If it was off, it will turn on. If it was on, it will turn off. This is the deactivation of the dimming logical switch. This is necessary in case you decide to turn off the light while dimming is in progress. The next automation is quite large and contains all the logic for controlling the light fixture's dimming. The initial block is similar to the one we just reviewed, but in addition to the unique name and identifier, it includes another line, the automation's operating mode. Restart means that if this automation is triggered again, the previous instance is stopped, and everything starts over. Here there are two triggers. One is needed to start dimming. In this example, I use the hold event. The other is used to stop it. Here, the release event is used. This is quite convenient. Dimming occurs as long as the button is held, and brightness is fixed when the button is released. However, the logic will work with any other events. Event names do not matter for automation. To make it easier to determine which trigger was activated, each is assigned its own identifier. Their names must be unique, but only within their respective automation. They can be duplicated in different automations. In the conditions section, there is a check to see if the light is turned on. Dimming brightness makes sense only if the light is on. In the actions section, A selector of conditions is applied. In this case, it is necessary because the automation performs a series of checks and, depending on the results, executes various actions. It is also critically important to maintain the correct order of nested blocks, which is determined by the indentation on the left. The order dictates the sequence and priority. The first condition is the activation of the trigger with the hold identifier. We assign this to the button hold event. If this condition is met, a sequence of actions is initiated. The first action is turning on the input Boolean dimming active. It is used as a necessary condition for changing brightness. Next is a nested block of actions that will continue as long as the virtual dimming active switch is turned on. The first step in this block is checking the state of the second input Boolean, which determines the dimming direction. If it is on, brightness should be increased. But that is not all the checks. The next step verifies whether the maximum brightness has been reached. The maximum value is 255, so a template is used here, in which the current brightness value is increased by the change step, 10 in this example. In percentage terms, this is approximately 4. If this condition is met, meaning the next brightness adjustment would reach the maximum value, the action to set the light fixture to maximum brightness, 255, is executed. The dimming active switch is turned off, stopping the brightness adjustment. The dimming direction switch is toggled to the opposite state, brightness reduction mode. If this check fails and the sum of the current brightness and the adjustment step is less than the maximum, the automation proceeds to the next block, where no additional conditions are present. Here, there is a single action, increasing the current brightness by a step of 10. Let me remind you that this scale has a maximum value of 255, so 10 is approximately 4%. You can set your own value, but don't forget to update it in the formula for the check as well. Now we go one level up, to the check for the state of the dimming direction switch. If it is off, the previously discussed block for increasing brightness is skipped, and it moves to this block, where the corresponding condition is specified. Here, too, there is a check, but this time for the minimum brightness threshold, which I set to 10, or about 4%. This is because when the brightness is zero, the light turns off. If the condition is met, that is, the next brightness change will either reach or fall below the minimum threshold. The light is set to a brightness of 10, the dimming switch is turned off, and the direction switch is set to increase. If the condition is not met, then the current brightness decreases by the specified step. You can set the step size and the thresholds to a level that is comfortable for you. Now we move up two levels. This is the repeat block specified in the actions triggered by holding the button. Here, a 1 second delay is set. This means the previously discussed blocks will run again and again every second, as long as the dimming active switch is on. In this example, the brightness changes by approximately 4% per second. If the logic we just reviewed pertains to the trigger with the hold identifier, then the next block, located at the very first level of nesting in the action section, is triggered by the release identifier. The automation restarts, as we set the corresponding mode in the initial block, and the dimming switch is turned off, while the dimming direction is toggled. Let's see how it works. The light is off, dimming is off. The direction is set to increase brightness. Turn on the light. Hold the button, the brightness starts increasing. Release it, the brightness is fixed, and the direction changes. Hold the button again, the brightness decreases. Release it, on the next press, it will increase again. What happens if you don't release the button? The brightness will continue to increase until it reaches the upper limit. After that, dimming will turn off, and the direction will change, even without a second event. The same will happen when the brightness reaches the lower limit. You can set the step value as well as the maximum and minimum brightness levels to what suits you best. Here's how the formula for checking works. It monitors the brightness attribute of the light. Currently, it is set to 10, the minimum threshold. start dimming, and the value begins to increase by the specified step. Stop it. Start it again, and now the brightness will decrease. Here's why the condition that checks the light status is needed. If you turn it off, the brightness value becomes null, and the formula won't work, as it requires numerical values, which only appear when the light is on. Let's consider a modification of the logic that works with a single event. I will use a double press of the button. Personally, I prefer this to holding the button until the brightness reaches the desired level. I added this to the same package, as its logic does not conflict with the previous automation. In this case, they work simultaneously. The initial block is identical to the one we already reviewed, except for the name and identifier, which are unique. The mode is the same. Restart. Here, there is only one trigger, a double press of the button. Therefore, an internal identifier, as in the previous automation, is not needed. The condition is the same. The light must be on. I just demonstrated why this is necessary. Next, in the action section, a selector of conditions is also used. Overall, the logic is very similar, with minimal changes. This condition is triggered if, at the moment of pressing, the dimming switch was off. In this case, it is turned on, activating the brightness adjustment process. Then the automation proceeds to the repeat block we already reviewed, which will continue as long as the dimming switch is on. This block remains unchanged. If the dimming direction switch is on, the brightness will increase in steps of 10. If it reaches the upper limit, dimming will automatically stop. Conversely, if the dimming direction switch is off, the brightness will decrease by the specified step of 10. When it reaches the lower limit, the process will stop. Until it stops, each dimming step will repeat once per second. The second top-level block, which the automation moves to if the trigger, in this case, a double press of the button, activates while the dimming switch is on. The automation restarts, the dimming switch is turned off, and the dimming direction changes to the opposite. A manual stop and fixation of the current brightness. If desired, the logic can be further refined, for example, by adding additional blocks that depend on the time of day. These can set different maximum and minimum brightness thresholds or adjust the color temperature. This logic can also be used for a sunrise alarm clock or sunset and sunrise functions. I discussed one implementation of this in a previous tutorial with a link in the description below the video. That's all for now. I hope this video was useful and interesting to you. Share your automation ideas, suggestions, and thoughts in the comments below this video. A text file with the package shown in the video can be found via the link in the description. There you will also find links to my Telegram channels, discussion groups, and social networks. Join us, it will be interesting. Thank you for your attention, and see you next time. Peace to all.